field cyber warfare and engage in that, you've got your direct effects, right? You've got your secondary effects, which you may be able to control the direct effects and the secondary effects, maybe you could keep more focused. But these cascading tertiary effects are a big area of concern. The fear was that if they destroyed the banking system of Iraq, that would then affect Iran and Saudi Arabia, and then from Saudi Arabia it would spread into Europe, and then spread into Europe back to the United States, and you get blowback. It's almost like the problem we have with nuclear weapons and you have fallout, right? We have that analogous idea in the possibility of information warfare. Read the article in the New York Times. One of the reasons that I'm going through this section here is our government, and in some cases your governments, are in this debate right now about how and whether to wage cyber warfare. The hacker community needs to have a voice in this, right? I mean, they're building their cyber warfare capabilities on the intellects that you folks have put in building different kinds of hacks, different kinds of exploits, in the research that you've been doing over much of the last 20 years. They're making that into warfare now. And you need to speak out, start blogging on it and so forth, because otherwise these decisions are going to get made. So I'm covering this section here to get you thinking about it, to get you speaking about it, because these decisions are being made as we speak. All right, you're familiar with the Estonian situation in 2007, right? It's very famous by now, where there were certain statues that were moved outside of a city in Estonia, and certain people that were sympathetic to Russian nationalism were unhappy about the movement of these soldiers, and a denial of service flood resulted. All right, so that was back in 2007. In 2008, before the invasion of certain cities by Russia in 2008 in Georgia, there was a volley, there was a cyber attack against some of the government servers and websites in Georgia. And this actually preceded the kinetic warfare, the actual rolling in of the tanks and so forth, almost anticipatory, very interesting. And then, did you see the issue in Kyrgyzstan in 2009? This got far less press, which I think was unfortunate. Kyrgyzstan was under a debate as to whether certain U.S. military bases should be housed in Kyrgyzstan. The Russians did not want those bases to be there, and suddenly there was a denial of service flood against various Kyrgyzstani government sites and so forth. It's interesting. Now, I'm not saying that Russia is the only one that engages in this. No, no, not at all. And I'm not even saying that it's the Russian government. I'm not saying that. However, it is interesting that this does come up on a yearly basis in association with certain issues dealing with Russian nationalism. There was also a smaller flood that happened the weekend of the 4th of July in South Korea and the U.S. Did you see that one? It was just a couple months ago. There's rumors that it came from North Korea or was inspired by folks in North Korea. I'm not here to say whether it was North Korea or not, but it was an interesting show of capabilities, a significant denial of service flood. Certain U.S. government websites were taken offline for a few days. You know, you hate to say this, but I was almost disappointed that the attack had such limited consequences, because I understand it was taken very seriously in South Korea. They said, wow, this is huge. But in the U.S., a lot of the government agencies just said, eh, it's just a little hack. It's not that big of a deal. And it didn't really have a huge impact on decision makers in the United States. Not that I want there to be a big attack with major consequences. What I'd like is there to be a small attack with small consequences that gets people's attention to this. Yes. So what are some of the U.S. approaches to dealing with cyberspace and the computer attacks and so forth? Well, the United States right now is working on appointing a cybersecurity director. You may be familiar with this. There's been several reports in the press and so forth. They're trying to choose an appropriate person to run government and also non-governmental civilian computer security issues in the United States. Legislation defines what the capabilities and roles and powers of this are going to be. Supposedly, this is going to be announced very soon. They said that 4 months ago, too. 4 months ago, it was supposed to be the imminent. They're going to announce it, and then, well, it never happened. And then in October, it was supposed to be October 1st, and then it never happened. We'll see. Washington, D.C. has been largely frozen up by the debate over health care, and that has kind of slowed down all other activity on behalf of the United States government, including the appointment of a cyber director. But I do believe we'll get somebody soon. Also in 2009, the United States military set up a U.S. Cyber Command. Their job, officially, is defensive operations in cyberspace. However, if you look at the definition of their capabilities and so forth, it does have offensive capabilities in there as well. All right? So the U.S. is moving into this space. It's somewhat controversial at certain places in the world, specifically in Europe. There are claims that saying the United States is militarizing cyberspace and this is a bad thing. Notice I'm being very neutral on here. In fact, in July of 2009, a couple months ago, 3 months ago now, the Russian government proposed a treaty with the United States to limit or entirely restrict the development of cyber weaponry and cyber warfare capabilities. The Russians proposed this, the United States rejected it. The official reasons for rejecting it were because the US said we should not focus on limiting offensive capabilities. Instead, governments should work together to focus on defense, defense, defense. This was a US official that actually said that. It's an exact quote. Defense, 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 that's where we've got to focus. They also said that this should be dealt with by law enforcement and not by some sort of international treaty that limits these capabilities. Those are the official reasons. What about some unofficial reasons that this may have happened? Well, from what I understand, one of the unofficial reasons for this is a treaty between the United States and Russia to limit cyber warfare capabilities that doesn't include China is really kind of meaningless, right? China's a major actor on the world stage. Their participation would be necessary to have this actually have some important meaning. So that was one of the possible unofficial reasons. Another unofficial reason, how do you detect when somebody's violated such a treaty? When organizations, when governments make chemical weapons, there are certain residues that are left behind that you might be able to inspect for. Yes, it's not perfect, it's hard, but it's possible. Or biological weapons or nuclear weapons require an industrial infrastructure that can be inspected, perhaps by satellites or inspectors going around. For cyber weapons, this is very hard to do. It really is. Think about it. If you were to hire four absolutely brilliant people, Dan Kaminsky-style intellects, and get them working on cyber weapons, from a governmental perspective, you could do that very cheap, maybe set it up for a few million dollars, and have the ability to wield significant control over target organizations. So that might be a possibility, the lack of the ability to even have some sort of enforcement regimen. Now, some people argue that cyber attacks are not a form of warfare. Let me give you a couple of examples. My buddy Mike Poore and I were talking just 2 months ago, and he says, cyber war, you're just sending packets. It's not real warfare, you know? That's what Mike said to me, one of my closest friends. Or I understand last year, Marcus Raynham presented here, and he was against the cyber warfare thing, saying that he thought it was all fear, uncertainty, and doubt, FUD, so that people could get more funding for, well, computer attacks and things that they wanted to do. I responded to my buddy Mike Poore by saying, you know, it has been accepted for hundreds of years that a blockade is an act of war. It just is. I mean, you look it up. A blockade is an act of war. Okay, if somebody were to bring down the internet for a country, wouldn't that be a form of blockade? I mean, what is a blockade? A blockade has a naval implication where you're sending your boats to block a port of trade so people can't get in or get out to do trade. So there's an economic impact. Well, if you bring down the internet connection for a given country or the internet connections, isn't that really a form of blockade? There are debates in the US right now as to whether this is a form of blockade. If somebody were to take Amazon.com down for a day, what would be the implications for the US or maybe your own country's finances, economically? Would that be the equivalent of a blockade? What are their motivations and who's funding them? Another issue here is a cyber attack as a precursor to a kinetic attack. Let me tell you, I was doing a presentation at the Pentagon, completely unclassified. I wouldn't be talking out of turn here. Completely unclassified. I was doing a presentation where I was standing up in front of the room and a bunch of folks in military uniform in the room, and I'm talking about a kind of computer attack and different ways to hack things in a scenario. And I'm going through the presentation, a guy raises his hand. I said, yes, sir, what's your question? He says, that machine up there, sir. I said, yes. He says, what do you do about that one if it gets in your way? And I said, oh, that one? Oh, you just blow it up. And I continued to present, and he raised his hand again. And I said, yes, yes. He said, sir, when you said blow that up, did you mean kinetically? Ooh. Well, you know, I'm a hacker. I just meant, like, you know, send him some malformed packets, blue screen to death kind of stuff. But if you have in your bag of tricks the kinetic attack, well, maybe the integration of cyber war and kinetic war, it hadn't crossed my mind to actually physically blow it up, because I'm not from that world, but there are people that are from that world. Okay? So, the concern here is that a cyber attack could be the precursor to a kinetic attack, like we saw with Georgia. It could actually incite the kinetic attack. A lot of people who are anti-cyber warfare bring this stuff up. They say, look, if you allow one country to hack another country, they may hack that other country, and the country responds by bombs coming back. So it could incite that. That's true. It's certainly a possibility. Please understand that I am not pro-cyber war. I'm not. William Tecumseh Sherman, he was a general in the U.S. during the American Civil War, he said war is all hell. War sucks, okay? That said, sometimes you need to have military capabilities. Consider this. What if your country decides to unilaterally disarm? You're not going to have cyber warfare capabilities, okay? And then you get hacked, and hacked in a bad way. The only way you'll be able to respond will be either to just take the kick in the teeth or respond kinetically. That's a bummer. Instead, if you have cyber warfare capabilities and you get hacked, you can respond in kind. All right? All right. Now, there is an issue that comes up here, the difficulty of attribution. I just chose letters at random here. But suppose we have a country called A and another country called C. And let's say these countries don't get along terribly well. I mean, they get along okay. There's a lot of trade between them, and you know the economies are very much intertwined and such. But they're not particularly happy with each other, let's say. But they certainly don't want to go to war. Let's say there's some other actor. We'll call him B. And suppose it's in B's best interest to incite a war between A and C, perhaps a trade war, perhaps an actual kinetic war. What if B were to hack C or A and make it look like the other side did it? We could have a very significant and very negative international situation tipped off here. This is a concern. The difficulty of attribution is real. I think a sufficiently determined attacker could make attribution almost impossible. However, some people cite the difficulty of attribution as saying, well, we can't do cyber war. You can never do it. But you know, attribution is a hard thing, no doubt about that. But sometimes actors on the world stage want attribution. They want to make it look. Look, I mean, Russia wasn't denying the fact that its tanks were rolling into Georgia. They were just saying that it's rolling into a part of Georgia that is rightfully theirs. Sometimes you know what country it is that is doing a given action. Attribution is not always difficult. It can be difficult, okay? All right, so conclusions. The world is changing. When I started doing information security, as I mentioned earlier, I wanted to make the world a more secure place. You know, I was a kid, real happy. I'm going to use these hacking skills to make things more secure and make things better. And it'll be unicorns and rainbows and nice, happy music. That was my vision for information security. And I now, as I'm growing a little older, I realize that was a nice vision for its time, but we're actually not moving toward that. We're getting more and more vulnerable. More and more of our critical infrastructure is getting more vulnerable. And I view the militarization of cyberspace as inevitable. I do. It's just something that is happening. You can complain about it. You can blog on it. But I do think it's what we humans do. Humans fight war. We fight war in the domains that we occupy. We fight war on land. We fight war in sea. We fight war in space. We fight war in cyberspace. I'm not happy about it, but I think it's inevitable. We can try to construct certain rules of engagement that are more reasonable, but I don't think you're going to stop it. Do you know what this picture is of? Does anybody know? It's Dr. Strangelove, yes. You remember that old movie, Dr. Strangelove? The subtitle of that movie was How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb, right? So this whole thing was about a military confrontation between the United States and the Soviet Union back in the 1960s. That's what the movie was about. Well, if you look at it, cyber warfare is actually a rather more civilized way of waging war, isn't it? My country and many of your guys' countries have, over the last 50 or 60 years, built a military infrastructure that was designed to vaporize in nuclear fire your enemies. That's awful, but that's what we've done. Now we're talking about cyber warfare, where you're going to hack your enemies. Look, if you are going to attack me and you give me a choice of nuclear vaporization of me and my family versus hacking me, I'm going to choose hack every time. Please, hack me. Right? It's a more civilized way of engaging in war. I was talking with a buddy of mine at the NSA about this, and I said, hey, hack me every time. He says, well, if they hack you and they completely disable and destroy the power infrastructure of your country, you very well might starve. So instead of dying in a millisecond, you might die a gruesome death over months. I said, I'll take that risk. Absolutely. I'm going to go hunting. I'm going to be eating roots out of the ground, whatever it takes, but I'll take that risk. So again, it's not the end of the world. So you could call this whole presentation How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Hack. Okay? All right. So I think we have a couple of minutes for questions or so. Yes? Are there any questions? Yes, sir. Please.
Do you get to Estonia?
Yes, sir.